Okay, then it's 8:05, and we should start our conversation to everybody who's already in. A very warm welcome from our side, Leica Singapore. Long time no see. So we are back from the summer break with another Leica conversation today. And to start with the most important person today, the speaker, I think I have not, I don't have to introduce to you because especially the Singaporeans. I think a lot of you already know him. His name is Peter Chong. And in preparation of that talk, you know, I always try to find out some special characteristics for the speakers. And in Germany, we have a saying that if you do what you like or what you love, you don't work a single day in your life. And the interesting thing with Peter is that he is actually combining two things that he loves a lot in his work. So he's loving watches and he's loving photography. And in today's session, we will hear about that. Talking a little bit about the watch part itself. So he's active in the community, I think, since 1919. So even before I was born. And in 2010, he actually released a book about Lange and Söhne. And in 2014, he founded the magazine Deployant. I hope I pronounced that Deployant, with two of his friends. So a magazine for watch lovers. And yeah, as I already announced today, we will see the combination of both of them. So very warm welcome to you, Peter.
Thank you. So, as Lucas has said, I started looking at this thing on a full-time basis since 2010. When I retired at 2010 to write the book on Lange & Söhne, I started with two different companies. One, dealing with the publishing of a book, because I found that it's a very difficult and very expensive exercise to publish a book. You cannot make money in a book. Because when I first went to some of these publishers, like the News in Germany, for example, they say, okay, we're willing to publish you because we kind of know you, but the split is 80-20 and we are 80 and you are 20. So it's kind of tough. So I decided, no, I do it myself. And then I did all the photography and the writing of the book myself. And that's why with the photography background, with the photography base, I started a photography business as well. So in a way, I'm offering this as a professional services to many of the watch companies. And that's how I started professionally. But I have been shooting and playing with cameras for a long time since I was a kid in school. I learned with film. We learned how to play with the darkroom, but I forgot most of it now because it's so long ago. And I think digital is quite fabulous. I'll start a little bit with also the kind of the history that I have with Leica. I have used the M6 and 3 before, but I don't have them anymore. I restarted the journey again in 2010 when I started this business and this new journalistic career. So I see myself more as a journalist for watches and now including cameras and photography equipment, because we have a column which comes up almost every Friday, not every Friday, but almost every Friday on deployant.com, which talks about cameras, photography, but of course, most of the time with a really strong slant towards shooting watches as a number one priority and then other things as number two and number three priority. So let's start with the first slide, which is the next one.
Before we start, I just want to inform everybody, same procedure as always. If you have any questions, please feel free to type them into the chat box and then I will ask them to Peter. Okay. I have one question before we start.
Sure.
Does it feel like work for you or is it just fun?
Most of the time it feels it's like fun, but sometimes it feels like work because we have deadlines. We publish daily. And this week particular, and last week, because the Geneva Watch Week is going on, we're publishing twice a day, so it's a lot of work. And for example, during the show times, previous years we will be in Basel and in Geneva for these shows. during those times, it's really tough work because we get up maybe 8 o'clock in the morning. We start meetings 8:30. I mean, Lulu knows. We finish after dinner at night, and then we go back. We process the pictures because we want to make sure that I have a backup, and then we start the next day again. And we are in the wrong time zone because we are in Switzerland, so we kind of already a bit dazed. And days are very long. We squeeze in 12 to 15 appointments a day, including interviews, photography sessions, press conferences. So can be quite tough, but I mean, really, I enjoy it. So in that sense, less tough.
I think if you really get challenged sometimes, this also brings the joy, you know, when you really I have done a lot of work.
Yes. So this is one of the starting projects that I did. This was those of you in Singapore may recognize and know this place. This is the L'Atelier by the, not L'Atelier, sorry, the Malmaison by the Hourglass. This is upstairs. So when they first started and opened this place, I did commission shoot for a magazine, and this was shot with the Leica S2 and the 35 S35 Submarine. So of course shot on the tripod because this was a very deliberate slow shoot. We only used two photographs from this session, and I shot maybe, unlike in film days where you probably shoot five or two usable photographs, we shot maybe 25. And I had an assistant who also shot as well with his Nikon. But these were the two pictures which I actually published. And I like this picture because there was no additional lighting done. This is available light in the showroom. And you can see that the colors are very vibrant. And I'll talk a little bit more about the S system. And this is a little teaser. It is actually the most favorite of my Leica. The most favorite Leica that I like. Not only this original S2, which is a CCD sensor, which has got very nice colors, but also the new ones, S007. I'm looking forward to trying the S3. So we maybe move to the next one. So it's a same place, different direction. Actually we have one more which is used, but I'm not showing it here. Because the other shot has got a shot of the bookshelf with my book open as well. That was also used. But I like the way the colors turn out. I like the way the rendering turn out. This was shot at very large, very small apertures. So the first one is an f13, the second one is f16. So there are no out of focus areas. Almost everything is in focus, especially with the 35mm. But what I also like is that the 35mm, as you can see, the sides, they are straight. You make sure that the back of the camera is level and facing straight, and the lens will take care of it. You don't have curved angles at the side. The lens is very linear, very rectilinear. And you can also see that this is the whole frame. You can also see that there is almost no vignetting. In fact, none. No vignetting at all. And particularly I like the colors and the gradation of colors. And this is, what makes medium format very appealing. The microtonal changes in the colors. If you look at the sofa, for example, the purple changes from dark to kind of light. And these microtonal changes, micro color changes, is what is quite difficult to capture with smaller sensor cameras. Yeah. Let's move to the next one.
Do you know that Leica has done a special edition with the Hourglass? I think it was about
five. Oh, yes, I know. I know.
It was the brass.
Probably 8 years ago, 7 years ago.
I think five.
M10. It was an M10 Hourglass edition, right? Yeah, I think they still have copies left, though. There's still some pieces left.
Yes, they have.
Yeah. I think it was, Yeah, there are some pieces. Oh, five? I don't remember the time, yeah. It was an M10, right, I think?
No, not M10. It was an M. I think it was the...
Eight or nine at that time.
Either M9 or M240. To be honest, I'm not quite sure, but...
Okay. And then continuing on the theme of medium format, and this was done with the S007. Per se, the medium format camera, you cannot use it to shoot events. You cannot use it to shoot harsh, difficult lighting. It is a studio camera. But this is not true. This is the Bell & Ross launch event in Singapore. This was on stage. It's a live band. I have no control of the lighting. I have no control of where this guy is going to move to. But this was shot with the S007, done at f/2.5. Huh? So the even though with a very short, wide open aperture, f/2.5 on the Sumarit 70mm, which is the maximum aperture, the camera can still get good focus. And the image is quite sharp. This is a little bit cropped because I was standing a little bit, I was standing down on the audience area, and this was up on stage. Yeah, and I think the action is captured quite okay. You can see that the two singers are quite sharp and quite detailed. I particularly like the skin tones, which is one of the characteristics I think of the Leica series, both the S and the lenses. I think they capture skin tones particularly well. Even though these guys were quite dark, you can see that the tones are very rich, and there's some gradations in the lighting. You can see that the face and it's quite nicely lit. Yeah, we move to the next one, which is also another event. This was also no way for me to plan this. If those of you who have attended this event, it's the opening ceremony of the Patek Philippe art exhibition last year in MBS. And these sponsors, I don't even know, I didn't attend, I mean, I never attended the any of the rehearsals, so I didn't know what they were going to do. And it just, as it happened, so we just take the photograph. This was done at f/2.8, also with the S007 and the Sumarit S70.
But that means that watch brands putting a lot of effort in their launch events.
Yes, normally yes. Watch events are can be quite spectacular. So it depends on the brand. So for example, in this case, it's a Patek event which happens once every, I think it's 4 years or 5 years, and they put a lot of effort in this. This whole show costs, I think, if I'm not mistaken, the published numbers were 5 million Swiss francs or something like that. So it's quite an expensive event for them to hold, and this event was a global event. So it was held in Singapore last year. Before that, it was in Mexico. Before that, it was in New York City, and before that, I think it was in Italy. I may be wrong with the cities. Not 100% sure. Yeah. But these were just dancers. They were moving quite fast, actually. They were moving quite fast, dancers, and the lighting is stage lighting. So there's no flash being used. And the camera was used handheld. F/2.8, it focuses, I think, good enough. This photograph, I don't think was cropped. It is a full image. Okay. The next one is...
Now we see you in action.
Yeah, the next one is basically a set of behind-the-scenes photographs taken by my friend Dimitri. This was done in Basel last year, where I had the SL. And I used the SL together with the TL60 for the entire Basel world. So all the photographs that you see appearing on Deploying website, and we had something like probably 150 watches were photographed with this combination. And this is how I do it. Maybe the next one, you can see a little bit clearer. Mm-hmm. Basically, a two flash setup. On the left-hand side, you can see a small Canon flash. This is an old flash that I have. I think it's probably 15 years old, but it still works. And it's triggered by Godox wireless trigger. And on the right-hand side, you see my Profoto Compact 600 flash. This is quite a big flash, quite a powerful flash. And with this two light setup, which is placed not directly in front of the subject, which is the watch inside the light tent, they create a balance of lighting. So the Profoto is set at quite a powerful light level, and the small flash is basically used as a trigger. So it's at 1/128 of power. So very little, but you can see in the photographs afterwards, as we will discuss, that it actually catches and becomes a rim light, which can be quite nice to highlight and separate the watch from the background. Almost all the time when I'm in shows, I use a standard configuration, f-stop, aperture, ISO, So almost nothing changes. And almost all the time, the watches are photographed against a black felt background, which absorbs light, so it kind of disappears. And then later, we don't normally do this much. It can be recomposited digitally if you need to. But for the deployed website, we almost never recompose it because we just show it as a product shot. On the right hand side, at the bottom, and the left hand side, at the bottom, you can see the watch that was placed there as this photograph was taken. In the next shot is
One question to this setup. So, if I compare that, let's say to a full studio setup with the big flashes and all that stuff, this one looks pretty simple, and that must be very, very convenient and nice for you that you don't have to carry around all the heavy gear for a big studio setup.
Yes. Yes. This is a kind of like a mini studio because I still have two lights. Mm-hmm. In my home studio here, I actually have three lights, two big ones and one small one. And then we can play with the lights as well. So for example, some watches have got curved surfaces, have got curved dials, which will somehow catch a hot spot somewhere on the dial. We have to composite the shot. So we move the light around and then we composite the shots where such that the light, the hot spot disappears after the composition, the DI work. Yeah, but this is light and small. It can go into a backpack, or when I go to shows, it goes into a small trolley bag, which is which I can carry up the cabins because I don't trust. Even when I travel with medium format gear, which is a much, much larger, yeah.
And in the first picture, I saw you standing and taking pictures. So you never use a tripod? And if not, why not?
No, I don't use a tripod because it's more difficult to set up a tripod. When in the shows, I almost never use a tripod. And we don't get shaky shots because I shoot at 1/1.25 seconds, which is the flash synchronization speed for the SL. And also the flash freezes the motion. Mm-hmm. So small changes, you freeze the motion. In fact, I even handhold the shots. I handhold the watch. Mm-hmm. The watch is held by hand so that you can get small variations, especially when the watch is not facing directly towards you. So it creates a little bit more interest in the posing of the watch, so to speak. But if I were to use a focus stacking, for example, if I need to focus stack the image, then the watch has to be in the receptacle and in a holder on its own, and then I have to use a tripod.
Yeah. And I think a setup like this for somebody who would maybe interested in doing micro photography, watch photography, whatever, by themselves, they can also get it, right? Spend their whole wealth for that. So.
I mean, yes, yes.
The flash, yes, I don't know how expensive that was, but the rest looks affordable for everybody.
Yeah. The flash is a little bit expensive, but it's not crazy expensive. I think this one, and it's quite old. This flash is about 10 years old. I think I bought it was $2,000. And I think the prices are more or less the same. You get a B-series Profoto for about the same price. And if you go for those Chinese ones like Godox and things like that, they're much cheaper. They're below $1,000 each. Yeah. And then this softbox, I actually had the Profoto one initially, but I decided to go with this really cheap one because then I use and throw. These are like $5, $10 or $15 each. Use and throw. Yeah. So I have a lot of this. Yeah. The next photograph I show how, the next slide, I show how portraits are taken. As you can see, when I attend shows, I actually wear a suit with a tie. So that limits your movement a little bit. Yeah, not so easy to move around, but it's part of the environment that we work in the watch show. This is done in Basel. You can see Basel World outside. And this is a very young watchmaker called Sylvain Pino. I will show his watch afterwards towards the end of the presentation. My friend Dimitri is holding a reflector so we can get a little bit better balance on the light falling on his face. So the big flash is on the right. The small flash is actually behind him so as to create a rim light at the back of his head. And then the reflector is used to kind of pick up the shadows on the part of his face, which is away from the key light. Yeah.
What is the process behind those things? For example, this guy, is he hiring you to do the shots or
no? Most of these shots are done for my own. For my own client, myself, which is a client. So it's done for deploying. 90% of the work I do today is done for deploying. Whereas previously, when I first started, as you mentioned, I started doing this photography at 2010, but I started only deploying in 2014. So the 4 years in between, I did quite a lot of work for other brands. I did work for Parmigiani. I did work for some companies which they, because of the NDA, we can't say who they are. Yeah, but I did work for some of the other brands. So I was frequently in Switzerland and in Germany and in Japan to do photography work for these people. But most of that has reduced quite a lot because I'm my own biggest customer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But I mean, for these smaller brands, I mean, you give them basically free exposure in your magazine, right?
So yes, correct.
You get anything in return? I mean, for sure you do it for joy, but...
No, we don't normally don't take any take anything in return. We don't ask them to pay for it. Mm-hmm. But if they have some money and they want to support the work that we do, we ask them to license some photographs for their internet or social media use. And some of them have done that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, but most of these small brands are too small to be able to commission work. Mm-hmm. And then the watches are not so mobile because if you commission work, normally it's for a new piece. And the watches are in Europe, it's difficult to send it back here for photography and go back. So most of the work is done in Europe, either in Switzerland, where there are some specialists who specialize in watch photography, and also a little bit in Germany and in France. Yeah. So some of these can be replicated. You see at the bottom, that's my bank. So everything goes into that bank. So it's quite compact. So the big flash, all the camera with two lenses or three lenses sometimes, all these reflectors and soft boxes and the small flash goes inside the bag together with a small tripod which I use for the flash, which I can also double up by changing the head and use for things like loom shots. I mean, people who are the watch people will understand what I mean by loom shots, but these are basically very dark shots with the luminosity of the watch glowing. But with that, for that you need an exposure time of about maybe 2 seconds or 3 seconds, depending on the watch. And therefore, we need a tripod for that. We need to hold the watch still and we need a tripod for that. So I have a small holder for the watch as well. And this is quite replicable and I've taught these classes before. And if you move on to the next slide, these are some of the watches that are shot by some of the participants of a class that I conducted with Leica in the MBS showroom sometime late last year, I think in November. And this is a participant shot. So using basically the same setup that I use, I showed you just now, they were able to create this set of photographs with their own watches. So I'll just go through them very quickly as to tell you what the watches and what the cameras are used by them to shoot this. The Seiko on the left was shot by Darren, and it was done with an SL. With a Summicron 90. So that's not really a macro lens, but you can still achieve a look like this because for internet use and for social media, you have the ability to crop. Even at 24 megapixels, you have ability to crop. The SL is only 24. You have ability to crop and therefore it's good enough for this. In fact, we printed this at A3 size and Darren took home this print. So the setups are all the same because they use my setup. F11, 125 seconds, ISO 100. Yeah. The Omega is done by Richard, and this is done with a Q2. The Q2 has a macro mode, so, or not Q2, Q has a macro mode, and therefore it can go quite close. Enough for shots like this. And if you don't blow it up too big, I think it's okay. It's quite nice. What I like about this shot particularly is the slight glare you see on the right-hand side of the watch, which kind of suggests that there is a glass there and that it's not totally empty. Yeah, and then the Rolex is done by on a CL with a TL 60 lens. Therefore, we have full frame, 1:1 macro, and this is a real macro situation. And this was done by a chap called Fraser. Yeah. So these are all possible, and of course the. Because the class was conducted by me, most of them are using the same kind of setup as I have done. In fact, exactly the same settings. And you see that the basic of the watch emerging from a dark background is the aesthetic that I like, and therefore they are all replicated in these photographs as well.
Yeah. It's very impressive that that you can shoot pictures like this.
Yeah.
Like without you know, much preparation knowledge. So no. For me, they all look like they can be printed in a magazine.
Yes, I think this most of these are good enough to be printed in a magazine. There's a little bit of DI work done, and this was done in a session. We started, I think, at 2 o'clock, and we finished at 5 something. And then 5 something, and they all went home with an A3 print. Yeah.
I have one question to this one. You said this one was shot with a 90.
Yes, Summicron 90. Yeah.
Is there a big difference for you between macro lenses and non-macro lenses? I mean, you said, of course, you can crop sometimes, but is there also an optical difference that you see?
There is a slight optical difference. Although for watches, we don't really notice it as much because macro lenses have a flatter feel. But for watches, the watch is not, the subject is not flat anyway. So it's not so critical. But we can usually get a bit more contrast and more detail from a micro lens. Okay. And especially if you want to print big, some of the work are printed quite big. For I think the next photograph is a large print. Is that right? Yeah, this is printed large. This is printed in a magazine called GMT in Switzerland. This was printed on, the magazine is A3 size, close. So you open it, it's A2, it's quite big. A2 is quite big. And this is printed right across from one end to the other end. This was done with the S2 with the macro lens, the S120mm macro lens. Mm-hmm. For me, really critical about this, I think it's a good image, but to me, it is still not the best possible image that can be produced because the S120mm macro only does half size, which means that this is a crop image. I would have loved to have a one-to-one macro where this will occupy the entire size of the sensor. So you maximize image quality.
Yeah. But let's say if you would use the S3 now with 64 megapixel, would that...
And then you still crop, but I always find that it's a bit of waste that you have so many megapixels and then you crop and you throw away some of it. I would prefer to use full, but having said that, it works. It works quite well. Even when with the SL, with just 24, and then you put in a TL60 lens, it crops to APS-C, only 10 megapixels. But for the work that I use for my own magazine, online magazine on deploying, it's more than enough. It's more than enough. And you won't be able to tell from looking at the photographs that it was heavily cropped. I mean, from 24 megapixels to 10 megapixels, quite heavily cropped. And the advantage of the TL, and I think we did discuss this a little while ago, or not with this group, but with another group, the benefit with the TL is that the TL is only 60mm, and therefore the close focusing distance, the focusing or working distance is shorter, and therefore you can do self wrist shots like this. One hand with the camera, this is the SL with the TL, and then like this. If you have a 120mm lens, it's like this. And by the time you shoot a wrist shot like this, you see that the hand is kind of cocked and it looks a bit unnatural. Whereas with the 60, you can do like this and it's still quite natural and quite nice. And therefore, that's one advantage that you can get out of this. And now with the SL2, with 47 megapixel full frame and 20 right, on APS-C, you have even more space to play with. But I think what's important is not only just the megapixels, but what's important is how the sensor sees the image. And in this case, I think the Leica sensors have got this little special thing that is able to have very nice contrast, very nice color, very nice changes in the contrast. Because contrast is one thing, right? It's between dark and light. But the many thousand different shades between light and dark, that's quite interesting. And I think that's quite nice, yeah.
And coming back to
I quite like, yeah.
Lenses, I'm not sure if a one-to-one would be possible with medium format.
Oh yes, it's possible. It's possible.
Then there must be another reason why we don't have it. But
I did ask, the response was that it would be very big. With the quality that you that you want to do, it'd be very big. For example, yeah. Phase one has a 120mm 1:1 macro, and so does Hasselblad, but only for the H system, not for the X system.
So that's then probably the reason, because I mean,
it'll be very big. Yes,
I think it's possible, but you know how big the lens would be and how much would be the
exactly. I think if you do it at Leica quality, it'd be quite expensive. But then again, you know. Phase one has done it with Schneider Kreuznach. That's quite a good lens, but it's also very expensive. And it's very big and very heavy. I've used it before as well.
One question here.
Yes.
We have one question here from Kevin. Is there a lot of post-processing done in that picture or only the crop?
With this picture? Not much post-processing is done in this picture. As you can see, if you look at the lux of the watch, you can see actually it's kind of like a flesh color. That's actually my hand, the reflection. So if there's post-processing, normally we will eliminate that by masking it. And then a fast solution is just to desaturate. It's very hard to see. But a professional solution, of course, is to mask and then do all those stuff to get rid of the reflections. By this case here, in the picture as you saw it, has very little post-processing. Just a little bit of vibrance. On ACR, I use ACR, a little bit of vibrance, very, very little, actually like 7 or 8, if I remember. I reprocessed this picture recently, and that's why I remember some of these settings. But no, not a lot, not heavy processing. In fact, most of the photographs don't have heavy processing because we are, most of the work, as I said just now, is done for my own online magazine, and we don't have time. We publish daily. We really don't have time to touch up a lot. So I spend typically 5 minutes, 6 minutes on one photograph. And each article has about 7 to 8 photographs. So that already adds up quite a bit of time. And I can't afford to spend like 1 hour on the photograph just to touch up everything. And those work that I do for brands, they touch up themselves because most brands have their own color, their own, profile that they use. And they touch up themselves. So we supply normally raw files. Previously people say don't supply raw files, but no, all the licenses are done with raw files or TIFF files, which are just converted from raw with very minor changes, like just a little bit of vibrance, a little bit on the exposure, if the exposure is not 100% correct. Because sometimes it does turn out to be a little bit, because depending on the watch, some watch don't reflect that much. Some watch reflect a lot, so you may have to touch up the exposure a little bit.
I like that. That's very authentic. You know,
Also, we don't clean up the watch. You can see here, at the top, next to the screws, there are a little bit of dust. I don't clean up the. Normally, for deploying, we don't clean up the dust. Very big pieces, very obvious one, we clean up, but the very small ones, I don't have the time to clean up. And if I send it, for example, and this is licensed to a watch company, of course, they do a lot of work to clean up. And you see that it looks, some of them have gone so much, so far that the work looks, the photograph then looks like a rendering. Yeah. Okay.
Then we go on to the...
Okay, this one is just a simple shot, just to demonstrate. This is with the SL and with the Summicron 50. Just to demonstrate the kind of resolution, even with just a 24 megapixel camera. This is a full frame shot. Nice bright sunlight, good contrast. I think it's quite a standard shot, but it's quite quite nicely handled by the camera. This was shot on top of I think Yan, 60th story or 60 something story of the Raffles City Hotel, and looking down into the Marina Bay, the CBD area. I have another photograph of this afterwards, which I think is the next one, right? Lucas?
No.
Okay.
How about the dynamic range first?
Okay, this one is, I shot this as a journalist to test the dynamic range of the camera. This is with the SL2. Let me see. This is number... What photograph is this number? 15, is that right? No. Okay, this is number 10, is that right?
I cannot see it if I'm on full screen, so.
Oh, okay, okay.
You.
I think this should be 15. Mm-hmm. Anyway, this was done with the SL2, and I purposely exposed this for the highlights. So, of course, then because of the dynamic range of the scene, the dark parts disappear. It become really, really black. But the dynamic range of the sensor is good enough that if in post-processing, I can recover most of it, which is the next slide. We recover most of it. And what's nice is that the recovery is such that there's not a lot of noise, not very heavy noise. There is little. If you do pixel peeping, of course, you will see it. But there's not a lot of noise. And what noise is there is quite consistent with the image. And the colors come back. The details come back. If you look at the pillar on the left-hand side, you can almost make out the texture of the pillar. And on the right-hand side, the leaves, you can, of course, make out the color of the leaves, which previously was completely black and you can't see anything at all. And now you can see that, in fact, the next slide, when we zoom into the girl, this was just taken downstairs in my pool. You see that she's wearing a bikini, which has two different colors. The top is black and the bottom is white. There's a little bit of noise here, but it is still not too bad. And I think the noise is quite consistent and what some of us would say, kind of film-like consistency. So it looks a bit like film. And to me, it's quite pleasant. Of course, it depends on your aesthetic.
And if you would apply a little bit of noise reduction, I think you can...
Yeah, of course. If you apply a little bit of noise reduction and sharpening, this is not sharpened. A little bit of sharpening, you will probably get a little bit better. This was done, I got it now. It's SL2 at f2.5, 1 over 5,000 seconds, ISO 100. This is with the Supercron 90. Okay.
Okay. There's one question from Anwar, but I would like to skip this one for later because he's referring to the previous one. So, and we will see some similar pictures to that. So that's why we skip that question for now and come back to that when we are talking about the close-up.
Okay. I'll take a drink, but I won't change language. Sorry, Singaporeans will understand. Okay, the next picture, this one is quite an interesting photograph because the SL now has this multi-shot mode or multi-pixel mode where it does, it uses the IBIS to move the sensor around at one pixel each time to create an image which is much larger than the base photograph, yeah, using a pixel shifting technology. So this is... this is a 187 megapixel image taken with a camera mounted on the tripod, of course. It's quite interesting to shoot this image because once you set it up and you shoot it, you press the shutter, you can set the delay, and then it goes on. And almost silent, because it uses the electronic shutter, it's almost silent, and it takes this image, and it compiles this image in camera. You get two images when you complete, one which is the standard 47 megapixel image, and the other is a 187 megapixel image which you see here. The two red areas are marked, the two areas which are marked, I will show in 100% 100% crop afterwards. But this is basically shot with the SL2 using the Super Vario Elma SL 1635. At 16mm, I think, if I'm not mistaken. F8, 1 over 60 seconds, ISO 100. This was done with a slight exposure compensation because the sky was very bright. It was a small exposure compensation. I think it's down minus 2/3 of a stop. But that's how we get this shot. But you can see, of course, a little bit on the boat key side, it's a little bit dark. But this can be recovered, although I didn't recover this for this particular photograph. The next one, you see one of the 100% crops. Next one, Lucas.
Yep.
100% crop. It looks a little bit unsharp, but it is not really unsharp, partly because it's a hot day. The air is moving a little bit. And also, no processing has been done to this 100% crop. So if you apply just a little bit of contrast, it will sharpen up quite a bit. This part where you see the JP Morgan logo and all that, it's just a tiny fraction of the image. If you go back again, See, it's just a tiny portion. This is the one on the right hand side, upper right hand side. So it's very, very small portion. You can't even see in this picture of the whole thing. You can't even read JP Morgan there. But when you zoom in, you can still see it in 100% crop. The next one is the more central one. It's also a little bit soft, but a little bit of contrast. It will sharpen up, it will tighten up a little bit. You can almost see the people sitting there. But of course, it's quite far away. I think probably 800 meters, 900 meters, or maybe a bit more away. And I think it's quite impressive that that we won with a multi-shot mode like this. We can capture a scene with quite a lot of detail. And especially with a little bit of processing, we can recover some of this, quite a lot of this.
Can almost see the watches of the people.
Yeah, 187 megapixels is quite a big file. It's, if your computer is a bit slow like mine, it's quite tough. It takes a long time to load. It can hang, or it doesn't really hang, but it can take a really long time. It seems like hanging. You can go for a cup of coffee and come back, and then it finishes processing because it's a very large file.
Yeah, that's right.
And then if you do a lot of processing on it, you add layers and stuff like that, it quickly becomes a few gigabytes size.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe we go to the next one.
Yeah, right. Before we talk about that,
yes,
there's one question from Sunil. He's asking you which watch you enjoyed the most to shoot. Do you have a favorite watch to shoot?
No watch in particular. They are all. As a watch lover, I enjoy all the watches. I like all the watches, including cheap ones like this one, which is my own watch. It's $139, if I'm not mistaken, plastic. But I like shooting this watch as well. And this one is used to show the IBIS capability. This is a handheld shot just right here on my table at f/2.8, ISO 100. And the exposure time is 1 second. So it's quite long, but you can see that the image is sharp, but of course the depth of field is quite small. This was done with a Sigma Art 70mm macro lens. The L Alliance is really quite fantastic because you can just put a Sigma lens, you can put a Panasonic lens on it, and it just works. It works completely perfectly without any adjustments. Autofocus works properly, just as fast as with the native lenses. The native lenses are a little bit sharper, a little bit better, but some of these lenses are a lot cheaper. So depends on what you want. So this is with a Sigma Art, and you can see that at this close distance, this is full frame. The full frame. In fact, Sigma Art here is shooting full frame 1:1 on the SL, on the full frame body. And you can see that the depth of field is very small. In fact, the entire Swatch logo is not even sharp. Only part of it is sharp because at f/2.8, depth of field is very, very small. But I could handhold it at 1 second. And if you look at right at the bottom, the end of my keyboard, it's quite sharp, so you can see the texture of the keyboard as well. Yeah. Available life, 1 second.
Is that the depth of field that you want to have in watch photography?
I don't shoot at this kind of depth of field, but I shot this to test the IBIS. Because I wanted a very long exposure time. In this case, 1 second. And it still managed to get a sharp shot. Okay, let's move on to the next one. Mm-hmm. The next one, this is a series of two photographs. This is the Leica watch. This is the L1. This was taken in Wetzlar 2 years ago in 2018 with the CL and the TL 60mm lens. The usual watch setup, F11, 1:1, 2.5 seconds, ISO 100. In that little light box that you saw just now, exactly the same technique. The small kicker light, as you can see, for the small flash, picks up a little bit on the left hand side of the watch, giving some definition to the edge of the watch. And then the bigger flash is on the right side, illuminating the dial and also the light side of the watch.
There's one question here from Pedro. He's asking, would you recommend to use a pole filter to get rid of the reflections?
In the field, no. It's too difficult to use. Polarizer filter is too difficult to use because you have to fiddle with it quite a bit. So normally I don't. If we shoot in the factory, sometimes we ask for the watchmaker to remove the glass. That's a little trick, which you don't get to use. You don't get to do unless you're shooting for the brand. They remove the glass to shoot it. And then sometimes we do two shots, one with the glass, one without the glass. And then we composite a little bit of reflection in, because if it's totally no reflection, it looks very strange. Yeah, although some watches actually look like that because of the anti-reflective capabilities of the coating that they put on the glass. So this is quite an interesting watch as well, because it's made in Vessler, mm-hmm. although it's made with a partner, which is a supplier to Leica as well. And that's why it has got name Leica on it. This is the L1. I think next one is the Movement. Mm-hmm. Same technique. Mm-hmm. So I think the Movement is a creation of a company called Lehman, mm-hmm. which makes this Movement exclusively for like their catalog. There is no mechanical watch. This is the only mechanical watch they produce, and it's used in the Leica. This is the L1 as well. Oh, this is the L1 as well. Yeah, there are two watches. One is L1, one is L2. They're almost exactly the same. The L2 has got, in addition, a rotatable inner bezel and a second time zone. Yeah. Okay.
So for this one, I think for this one, we can throw in the question from Lulu.
Okay.
So she was asking, like, for those kind of picks where we have the very small details and all the movements like this one for over here, which camera you would recommend to use for? And by the way, which lens would you recommend?
I think the CL with the TL60 works very well, because it's a APS-C size sensor. Maybe there's going to be a CL2, which is a bigger set, more megapixels, but currently I think it's enough as it is. And with the TL, it's 1:1. You get 1:1 macro, which means you can get a lot of details. But of course, you cannot blow it up very big. So if you want a picture which is the size of a wall, it's going to be a little bit challenge. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's going to be a little bit challenge, especially if you want to look at it very close. If you look at it from far, it's okay. If you look at it very close, it's going to be a little bit challenge. You will need more megapixels for this particular purpose. But for web use, for small print, for like print, even print size of a magazine, full page, for example, for Lulu, even your cover page, this image can work very well. Not a problem at all. I don't find it a problem at all. For me, I just prefer the form factor of the SL, and that's why I shot the entire Basel World with the SL instead of the CL. I had the CL with me as well. I shot it entirely with the SL because I prefer the form factor and the holding of the SL. The SL2 is even better, because when they first say that they changed the grip, I thought, oh no, the grip is already perfect. Why did you change the grip? But when it came, this is even better. The new grip is even better. So yeah, same with the interface as well. You know, when you first read that, oh, the interface has changed. Now it's got three buttons on the side instead of four buttons. I said, oh, why? It's already perfect. But when it came and you used it, it's perfect. It's even more perfect. It's even better now. And I'm not just saying this because of anything to do with that Leica is hosting the session, but really I feel that the SL, I like the form factor of the SL.
And I think it's funny, like how such a small detail, like the grip, for example, can make such a big difference. So it's only a small hole now and the rubber inside the grip. And when we gave the camera first to customers, they're like, wow, this feels totally different.
Yeah. It feels like a totally different camera. It's just a little bit cut off from the grip, and the grip is maybe a little bit bigger, but that's it. Very small millimeter changes, but big difference in the experience. Now you can hold it very nicely. Well, previously you can hold it very nicely too. That's why I thought if you change the grip, it's going to be worse, but it's better.
There's one question here from JK. When this watch will see the light? So very soon. So don't know if you have seen recent posts from our chairman, Dr. Kaufmann. So we know that we are a little bit behind, but he said there will be will be something. So
okay, next one.
But no confirmed date yet, but it will happen soon.
Are you talking about the CL2?
No, the watch.
Oh, the watch.
Yeah. See, no CL2. Don't.
That would be interesting because I think the CL now is a little. For APS-C sensor, it's a little small in terms of megapixels. I would prefer more. Because more is always better.
Yeah. Okay.
To a certain extent, yeah. Okay, this one is just to demonstrate. This one is taken with the SL. I was walking around the streets of Paris, and just basically to demonstrate kind of a touristy shot. It's nothing special about this shot. It's just a corner cafe. So I just turned around and took a photograph, and this is what I got. Very little processing, actually. Very, very little processing, except for resizing and a little bit of tweaking of the levels. But in the big image, this is just 24 megapixels. Remember, this is SL, not the SL2. With the SL, 24 megapixel image, you can actually read the signboards, the little menu boards. They are visible because the image is sharp enough. And you also see that at the sides, the lamp posts are not curved. They're straight. And this is taken with the 1635 as well. So very wide angle at 16 mm. I really like very, very wide angles because I like the kind of way you can compress the image. And and this was done at F4, 1/8 of a second. So it's quite slow as well. And this was without IBIS, no IBIS as well. But you can see that the image is reasonably sharp. If you're very, very critical, you can see that, yeah, it's not really 100% sharp. Because if you zoom in, you can see it, but even printed, it's okay. I have printed this in a kind of a smallish book, a B4 size book, and this covers one page of the B4. It looks okay. Yeah, you can't tell that it's not sharp or it's and the colors are really nice. Yeah,
I really like those images. Nowadays when people say like, why do I need a camera? I have one in my smartphone.
Oh, different.
Take a picture like this with your smartphone and you will see the difference. So you will get those light conditions, you will get nothing
out of it. Big difference. The other challenge here is that you can see that the lighting has many different color temperatures. They're all different colors, right? Inside the restaurant is kind of like very warm, but you can see on behind this guy on the left, it's blue because there's neon lights there. And then upstairs, fluorescent light in the room. And then there's tungsten street lamps. So it's a very, very heavy mixture of lights and it's quite challenging. With film, this is going to be a very, very difficult photograph to take, unless you shoot black and white.
Okay, then
okay.
Go back to the watches.
Okay. This is just a photograph done for Moser, actually. This was done for Moser. This is Bertrand Melan, one of the brothers of the family who owns the company. And this was done in Yan during an event. So basically, this is just to show portraits. And this is done with the SL, with the Summilux 50 at f1.4. So very, very shallow depth of field. I like the out of focus areas at the back. I mean, I like the bokeh. Some people may not, but I do like the bokeh. I think it's quite nice. And then the plane of focus where his eyes are actually very, very sharp. If you look at the original, the full size image, you can see his iris and the patterns of his eye. Okay, then next
we have
a series of watches. You have more questions?
One question from Santo. He's asking, would you prefer a full frame sensor with maybe a small amount of megapixels or a crop sensor with more megapixel?
Interesting question. As long as there's enough, I prefer a full frame with a smaller number of megapixels, but it can cut both ways. I wrote an article on deploying on Micro Four Thirds, which is the smallest kind of like semi-professional cameras that you can get with a 2:1 crop from full frame. Mm-hmm. And it's advantageous for shooting watches. And the reason is because on the MFT, on the Micro Four Thirds, your depth of field, perceived depth of field, is bigger. You get more of the object in focus for the same focal length. For example, in my MFT format, I use a Panasonic with a 45 mm macro lens. They're 45 micrograms cast 1:1 on the sensor. And therefore, a lot, because it's 45 mm wider, a wider lens has got more depth of field, you get more of the watch in focus. You can shoot at f8, f11 instead of, for example, if I shoot medium format, f22, you're kind of more or less there, but then you're starting to get diffraction. So with medium format, you need to use focus stacking, stacking as a technique. So it's much more complex to shoot with a larger format a sensor. So of course, full frame is somewhere in the middle. Full frame is kind of like a sweet spot. APS-C is a little bit smaller. Full frame is it's quite a nice sweet spot. Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Go on, the next few photographs. I think we're also running quite late, but the next photographs are just watches. This was done in Basel with the SL, and all of them are the same settings. F11, 1/100, ISO 100, 60 TL, the lens. This kind of pose for the watch is called the Cobra, where the watch is actually slanted backwards. The front, the bottom of the watch is actually closer towards you than the back of the watch, and you can see this in the depth of view, even at F11 with a full frame set. It is APS-C, yeah. So this is SL, but when you put the TL on, it becomes APS-C. On the even on the APS-C sensor, you see that not the entire dial is in focus. So this is where two different tools can be pressed to use, and we use them. I use them quite a lot as well. One is focus stacking. Many ways to do focus stacking, and two is to use a tilt shift lens. So you can also tilt the shift lens, use the Chamfluck principle to get the entire dial in focus. And that's what we use in a big studio. So if I shoot in a big studio, sometimes I use that. But when this is shot in Basel, so no time to do that. I have maybe 15 minutes to do this. Yeah. Next one. This is a crop. This was licensed to Chapek, which is the company, where this watch is. This is the Tourbillon. We can see the detail. Same setup, SL with the TL 60. What I really like about this rendition is you can see the very smooth tones of the polished bridge of the Tourbillon. It changes, but it's very smooth, and the camera captures this very well. You try and shoot this with an iPhone, for example, no matter how good it is, you will see that the color gradation between the very bright spots and the darker spots, slightly darker spots, are going to be so much that you can, if you're really critical, you can see kind of bending. But here, you don't see any bending at all. This is quite similar across the range. So with the SL, with the CL, I think it's quite similar as well.
There's one question from Kervin. He's asking, do you use LED lights also from time to time, or only flash?
No, I only use flash. Yeah.
Okay.
Some people do use LED lights. There are advantages because you can see reflections on the light on the watch before you shoot. But I prefer flash. I've been using flash all along, and it's just not something I have explored a lot. Yeah.
Okay.
The next one I'll just also watch for. This is the Pernod watch that we saw just now where I took his portrait. You can see on the left-hand side, again, the small little flash is able to outline the watch and separate it from the background. With better processing, you can probably see the strap as well, but here I didn't process it that well because this was done for my website deployment, and basically a couple of minutes. But I think the watch comes up quite well. Mm-hmm. And you can see the movement, and you can appreciate the depth of the movement and the mechanics of the movement. The next one. This is a very close-up detail. Same setup. This is crop image, of course. This is of a very high-end watch of the Ferdinand Berthou. This is FB1, and this is a crop of the Tourbillon. You can see here the really fine finishing. The kind of view you get here is almost the same, or maybe a little bit bigger than the field of view that when you look through a 3x loop, you can see this kind of details. And that is the standard loop used by watchmakers. Yeah. At the bottom, again, you can see that gradation, the smooth gradation of the dark to bright. And this watch is running. So that's why the flash freezes it, but not completely. So some parts are still kind of slightly blurred because there's motion blur.
Yeah.
Yeah. For example, that part there, that which is the balance wheel. That's the the inertia screw of the balance wheel. But you can see below, the fifth wheel or the escape wheel and the pallet, the Swiss anchor pallet, are sharp because this is moving a little bit slower. Here you can see a lot of the finishing details, which are really, really nicely done with this watch. You can also see the chain of the fusee chain on the left hand side. Yeah, the chain is blackened, but you can see the chain. It looks like a bicycle chain for those of you who are not familiar with watches at this level. But it looks like a bicycle chain, and it actually is a bicycle chain. It's a kind of like a miniature bicycle chain. About 700 components are required to make one chain. Yeah. Okay, next one. I think it's the last shot. This is just a reshot. This is done with the TR, and this is the advantage of the TR because, as I said just now, you can just do like that, and you can see that my hand is not kind of like twisted up. I would have to be if it's much longer. Let's say it's a 120 mm. Your working distance is longer. Then you have to twist the hand, and this was also licensed to CHAPEC. I cannot show too many of the pictures that are licensed to other the brands because some of them have exclusive rights to them. So sometimes this shot, for example, is an off take. I took two of this. The one licensed to him is slightly different from the one here. The one that licensed to him has a slightly, it's shot at F16, so it's slightly more depth of field. That you see the near end of the at 7 o'clock is a little bit soft. The one that's licensed is not soft at all. It's sharp all the way. And the F16 with the SL, it is almost at diffraction limit, but not quite yet. So we can still tweak it in Photoshop by using filters, sharpening, a little bit of sharpening, and that goes away. Before I end, I just wanted to kind of cover that in this series of photographs, I've used mainly four cameras, the CL, SL, SL2, or five cameras actually, S2 and the S007. And even though the S is kind of a big, heavy camera, somehow I feel that the rendition of the S is much nicer than the rest. The SL is very, very technical. Those of you who maybe play with hi-fi, for example, the S is like a very nice, the SL is like a very nice, very accurate solid state amplifier. And the S is a little bit softer. It's a bit like a tube amp, a bit more beautiful, a bit softer. Not that to say that technically it's not as good, but it gives me that feeling that it's a bit more character. Whereas the SL is a little bit more technical, maybe a bit more German. So maybe a bit more suitable for Leica, a bit more German. And a bit, but it still has quite good character. So I think that's the last, this is the last slide, right? We end here unless you have any more questions.
Nice comparison. We have one last question from Daryl. And he's asking, given the importance of light, was it difficult to shoot the Venta Black dial? And in general, is it very difficult to shoot totally black watches compared to what we have seen here, for example?
Dark dials are more difficult because they tend to catch reflections at the wrong places. The Venta Black was not the most difficult watch, but Moser watches are very difficult to shoot for two reasons. One is that the dial is curved, so that gives you all kinds of strange reflections that you can pick up, hot spots. And number two is the crystal is also curved and sometimes not curved in the same angle or same shape. And therefore, you get two different kinds of reflections you need to deal with. They are quite difficult to deal with, like the Moser Endurance, the Moser Ventura. They are quite difficult to shoot. Black makes it one more step more difficult. Yeah. So normally for watches like Venta Black is a bit easier because Venta Black has no reflections. The material is such that it's basically little pieces of trees standing up. They are carbon microtubes standing up, and the light goes in and doesn't reflect. Everything is captured inside. That's why it's totally black. So you don't get any reflections. The only reflection you need to deal with is the crystal. And if you shoot in a factory environment, of course, not available to normal people shooting outside. Shoot in a factory environment, we remove the crystal to shoot. We do two shots, as I said just now, one with and one without the crystal. We put back the crystal shot with a little bit of reflection, maybe at 25% or something like that, opacity.
Okay, yeah. And I have
to answer the question.
So to conclude everything what we have heard today, what kind of tips and tricks and recommendations you could give us in terms of macro photography. So if anybody who is not so familiar with it wants to explore more and want to start, which advices would you give them?
I think the most important thing is to just start. Just do it. Make the mistakes. Ask people who know. Start up with a simple setup like the one that I've shown. Start up with a standard posing of the watch. Start up with a standard setting of the camera. So I normally shoot manual, 1/1/25 seconds, f/11, ISO 100, because you want maximum image quality. The two lighting that I showed just now, they are set somewhere in the middle, except the small light set at the minimum 1/1/28 of the maximum power. The big light is set somewhere in the middle, halfway, depending. At f/11 is halfway, f/16 is almost full, but you have to experiment with it. You have to play with it. I just saw a video by Carl Taylor just now. He's talking about using flash meter. He said his advice is throw away the flash meter. Nowadays, digital, you can just shoot, and then see the image. Don't like it, make some changes, shoot again. I mean, every single image you shoot costs almost nothing. Just one activation of the camera. So it's very, very tiny little wear and tear to the shutter. That's it. And you said this advantage now. If you shoot in film, it's very expensive to play with this experiment.
And you said ask an expert. I think that's also a very good recommendation. So for those who want to learn more about that, you see in the chat box, we have shared two links with you. So one is for a macro workshop. So if you say like, I would like to explore more over here with a little bit of guidance, then you can sign in over there. And of course, also the different gears that Peter has talked about today can also be found on our Leica store homepage. So then, Peter, as always, I really enjoy it if I learn something new. And I think now after approximately 15 or 16 Leica conversations, it's still not boring for me, because every time I learn something new for myself, and I think the participants in this evening also did. And thank you very much to you for your
time,
your effort, and also for the previous work that you have done with us. So for example, the Leica Playground, we have done a workshop together, and I think there will be even more in the future.
Okay, good.
Good, then to everybody, have a nice evening. And as I said, please check out the both links over there, and also previously, a little bit more on top, the link for Peter's homepage has been shared. The link for the Watch Magazine Deployant. So if you are interested to check this one out. And as always, the session is recorded. So in a couple of days, you will find the session on Facebook and later on our YouTube account. Let's say for
okay,
your friends or something like that could not make it today, you can still watch it, or if you enjoyed it so much that you want to see it again.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much, Peter. Have a nice evening, and take care.
Yep. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Okay.
Was very good. I think in the end we had over 40 participants.
Okay.
Very nice.
Thank you, Peter.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks, Sherry.
Thanks so much.
Okay.
Good talk.
Stop sharing.
Very engaging.
Thank you.
Thanks, and we catch up soon again. Okay.
Yep. Sure. I'm going to leave.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Have a good night rest. Bye-bye.
Bye.